5th as Bob McKenzie, Darren Dreger, and Pierre Lebrun bring you comprehensive coverage of every story and trade from every angle and platform. Tune in for all-day coverage beginning at 8 a.m. Eastern, 9 a.m. Atlantic across the TSN network. Here's a look at our trade bait board. Artemi Panarin at the top of that one. Right below him is Duchesne, and obviously a couple of tough guys. You can put the puck in the back net with Simmons and Ferland. Not often you see a pick on the board as well. The Jets had their first-round pick up there. Here's a look at the next five players. Bobrovsky sitting at 10. Fantastic goaltender. Most teams are probably going to take a stab at here. But with more, let's go to Gina Retta and the boys.
There, the insiders, Bob McKenzie, Pierre LeBrun, and Darren Dreger. Darren, you mentioned that on Monday, Pierre Dorion, the general manager of the Ottawa Senators, met with Matt Duchesne's agent, Pat Brisson, in Ottawa for a few hours. What came out of the meeting?
Well, Pierre Dorion is trying to sell his player, Matt Duchesne, in this case, on the merits of signing long-term with the Ottawa Senators. So Pat Brisson is there to listen to the sales pitch. What is the long-term plan and the direction of the Ottawa Senators? Really, how deep is this team, positionally speaking? And how quickly is it going to be before the Ottawa Senators are recognized as a real playoff contending team? So there was a bit of a sales job in that, you know, few-hour meeting with Pat Brisson. Now it'll be up to the agent and the player to have a continued dialogue, but at some point in the real near future here, Matt Duchesne is going to have to make a decision.
And that, Darren, is the real crux of everything in Ottawa. And I was going to say something that's stupid. Forget the money, forget the term of the contract. Those are all important, but secondary to what Darren just talked about, and that is for these players to have an understanding of position by position, player by player, prospect by prospect. How are the Ottawa Senators going to turn themselves from one of the worst teams in the National Hockey League to a much more competitive team in a time frame that suits Duchesne and Mark Stone? And do you believe, do you have faith that the organization, from the ownership to the management to the coaching staff on down, can execute that plan in your lifetime or before your lifetime when that contract expires? We also get a very strong sense right now that most of the focus and energy at this moment in time is more on Matt Duchesne than Mark Stone. That's not to say that couldn't change over the course of the week, but right now it seems like all the effort, focus in Ottawa is trying to get Duchesne, to convince him to be a part of this.
And I think there's contending teams that are waiting to see what pans out with Mark Stone before they decide to put all their chips in and make an offer on another rental player that's out there. Just like when Artemi Panarin went on the market last week, that made a lot of teams sit back and say, whoa, I got to investigate this and find out what the price is before I go somewhere else. So Panarin, Stone, really having a cooling effect, I think, on the secondary market. Guys from Michael Ferland, whom the Hurricanes would have moved last week if someone would have stepped up, but now they're waiting, they're in a holding pattern. And what about Wayne Simmons? A lot of interest for Wayne Simmons of Philadelphia Flyers. They've won 8 straight games, and teams are wondering now that they're in the playoff chase, will they keep Wayne Simmons? I'm told that no, more likely than not, they will in fact still trade Wayne Simmons if and when someone pays up with the right offer, because they have to get assets for a guy that they know they're not going to sign and that will be gone July 1st.
Last week when we did insider trading, you mentioned the fact that now that Sergei Bobrovsky's out there, expect Florida to be interested. What's happened on that front?
Well, Florida did reach out to Columbus, is my understanding, and what they found out was the price was too high right now to get into that. Too high because they know they can go after him as a UFA July 1st. So to me, what's going to happen here is Florida will keep in touch with Columbus. They'll circle back closer to the 25th. If the price goes down, maybe it's worth it for them to try and sign Bobrovsky now and advance the process. If the price hasn't changed, they'll wait till July 1st.
I'm going
to
jinx myself a little bit with this by saying that things have cooled around the Los Angeles Kings, because that can change with a simple phone call. But yes, calls are being made, and the usual suspects seem to be the target, including veteran goaltender Jonathan Quick. But he has 4 more years remaining on his contract at $5.8 million. The sense that I get from my sources is that if Jonathan Quick legitimately gets traded, it's more likely that it'll happen at the draft, on the draft floor, than it would be before February 25th.
What's the latest on the Edmonton Oilers GM search?
Well, the process continues, but we are expecting that the Edmonton Oilers later this week are going to begin to start reaching out to other teams to ask for permission to talk to managerial candidates. Now, we don't expect the timeline to be accelerated. In other words, we're not expecting a new general manager to be named before the trade deadline. And in fact, this could be something that drifts a lot longer than that. But the process sounds like later this week, it's going to take the next step, which is actually contacting teams, getting permission, and getting into more of the heart of this matter.
Things are getting intense. We are now under 3 weeks to the NHL trade deadline, so things are heating up for all of our insiders.